Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Well, welcome to St. Peter's Church here in West Blatchington in Hove for our online and telephone service on this feast day of St. Luke. In our Bible reading, we're going to be hearing about one of Luke's accounts of the Acts of the early church. But we're also going to be thinking about what do we do when our hopes and our dreams seem to fall down around us. Perhaps you've experienced that this year with our pandemic, or perhaps it's not related to that at all, but you're still experiencing that at some point. In which case, it's my prayer that today's service, God would speak to you and encourage your hearts in the Lord Jesus. We're going to begin our service now by saying this prayer of preparation, where we ask God to ready our hearts to worship him. We say together, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. We now have the opportunity to confess our sins together. Perhaps you're mindful of something that you've done or haven't done and you want to ask God's forgiveness. The great news is that through Christ we can experience complete forgiveness for all of our sins. So let us confess our sins to Almighty God, confident in the grace that is ours in the Lord Jesus Christ. Together we say, Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So may the Father of all mercies restore you in his image, cleanse you from your sins, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. They went through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. When they had come opposite Mysia, they attempted to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. So passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas. During the night, Paul had a vision. There stood a man of Macedonia pleading with him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." When he had seen the vision, we immediately tried to cross over to Macedonia, being convinced that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. We set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is the leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in the city for some days. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
May I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. All of us have hopes and dreams, things that we want to happen in our life, things that we look forward to. And some of these things are quite straightforward to achieve. Some of them require a bit more planning, and some of them are just completely out there, like me winning a sprint stage in the Tour de France. Not really going to happen. But they're still our dreams, and they're still important to us, aren't they? We dream, we hope to do well in exams, we hope to get married, we hope to have children, we hope to have a rewarding job, we hope to retire and enjoy a long and happy life. But what are we to do when we face setbacks to our hopes and dreams? When we end up in a job we don't enjoy, or where poor health makes travel plans impossible, or singleness, or divorce, or miscarriage, or infertility rob us of the things that we have dreamed of for many years? How do we process this when our hopes and dreams come crashing down? Well, today we're going to be looking at our reading from the book of Acts to help us to understand how we can trust God even when our hopes and dreams seem to fall away. So let's have a look at our reading. And the first thing I want to say is that sometimes from our point of view, what God is doing doesn't seem to make all that much sense. Verses 6 to 8 say, they went through the region of Phrygia and Galatia, having been forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. When they had come opposite Mysia, they attempted to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit of Jesus did not allow them. So, passing by Mysia, they went down to Troas. In this part of the book of Acts, the Apostle Paul and some of his companions are on a missionary journey. They're taking the good news of eternal life through Jesus Christ around the Mediterranean. And so far, they've got as far as modern-day Turkey. Now, we know that Paul was originally a persecutor of the church, wasn't he? He was trying to wipe out the Christians. But in Acts chapter 9, he meets the risen Messiah, and his life is changed forever. This Jesus commissions him with a task to share the good news of life in his name out into the world. And this becomes Paul's hope, his dream. It becomes the purpose for his life. And actually, that's the same for us as Christians today. We want to see our parish, our city, our whole world come to know the light, love, and life that comes through Jesus Christ, the Son of God. But something happens. We are told that they were forbidden by the Holy Spirit to speak the word in Asia. Now, Asia here doesn't mean the whole continent as we think of it today. It's talking about the southern part of Turkey. And it's somewhere that God is stopping Paul and his companions from entering. It says in verse 7, when they tried to go into Bithynia, the Spirit of Jesus didn't allow them. Now, we don't know why this is the case. Maybe it wasn't the right time. Maybe the people weren't ready to hear the message. Maybe it wouldn't have been safe for them to go there. So Paul and his friends find their plans, their hope, come to an end when they reach Troas, basically reaching the end of the road. If we think about the geography of our country as an example, it's like imagining you're trying to cycle around the whole of the British coast, but when you get as far as Cornwall, all of the roads leading out of it are blocked, and eventually you get to Land's End, and then you've got nowhere else to go. It appears that Paul's plan for sharing the gospel in that place is over. From his point of view, it wouldn't make all that much sense what God is doing. I mean, why wouldn't God want to send them into these other towns and cities so they can share the news there? They were there, they were ready, they had the message, but no, it's not God's plan at this time. But they wait. That's all they can do, they wait. And sometimes that's all we can do too. When our dreams and hopes seem to come to an end, we wait. I mean, take for example this pandemic. We can throw our hands in the air and say, what is God doing? And we may be able to come to some conclusions, but the honest answer is, we don't know. To us at the moment, it doesn't seem to make all that much sense. But you see, it doesn't actually have to. God isn't asking that we would know all the answers to why he's doing things. That's not how he works. But he is asking us to patiently trust him. So don't give up when you don't understand what he's doing, when your dreams and your hopes come to an end or are put on pause. Instead, wait patiently for the Lord. And that's made easier, like with Paul, when you're in the company of other Christians who can support you, who can pray for you, and just be there waiting patiently with you. So you see, while from our point of view, it may not make all that much sense what God is doing sometimes, the second point is we rest in the fact that God's plans are greater than we can imagine. During the night, Paul had a vision. There stood a man of Macedonia pleading with him and saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. When he had seen the vision, we immediately tried to cross over to Macedonia, being convinced that God had called us to proclaim the good news to them. So while they wait, seemingly at the end of the road, Paul has a vision. And it's of a man. But he's not a man from the country where they currently are. It's a man from across the sea in Macedonia, in northeastern Greece. So if you imagine we're back at Land's End, it's like an Irish man calling over from across the Irish Sea. And did you notice this Macedonian man is calling for help? It's like the cry of someone in the sea, calling to the shore, lifeguard, to come and rescue them. But what does this help entail? Why are they asking for it? Well, the help that Paul is able to offer is the gospel, precisely what he's been sent to do. It's the public announcement of the fact that Jesus is the Messiah and in what he has done. But how does that help someone? It helps because it addresses the deepest need that all of us have, whether we're from Turkey or Macedonia or Hove. The help we need is to be rescued from sin and death and instead given forgiveness and eternal life. It's the help that our souls need. The call is there, not what they were expecting, but it is there. But responding to this call for help is going to require a drastic change of plan, a whole new direction for Paul's missionary journey. No longer confined to Asia, but now crossing the border into Europe. And it's at this point where we begin to see how God's plans are actually greater than we can ever imagine. Something changes in these verses. I wonder if you noticed it. St. Luke, the physician, is writing the book of Acts. And did you notice how he describes the book at the beginning? Let's have a look. He uses they, doesn't he, to describe them? But now look at verse 10. After the vision, he says we. and us. So Luke, the writer of the book of Acts, is now part of this group who are going over to Macedonia. He's joined Paul and the others, and that's actually why we have this reading on his feast day today. And this is significant for two reasons. Firstly, and this is a good one, they now have someone else to help them on their journey, to share in spreading the gospel. And Luke also happens to be a physician. He's a doctor, which is certainly useful if you're travelling around 2,000 years ago. Great to have a doctor with you. But more importantly, it's what Luke will go on to do in recording this book and his gospel. In the beginning of the gospel according to Luke, he writes this: "Since many have undertaken to set down an orderly account of the events that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed on to us by those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and servants of the word, I too decided, after investigating everything carefully from the very first, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the truth concerning the things about which you have been instructed." Luke's purpose in writing his gospel and the book of Acts, which is basically the sequel, is to give us certainty about the stories so we can believe them. He's carefully researched the different eyewitness accounts of Jesus' life with the apostles so that we can trust that it is true. But if Paul wasn't stopped in Troas, if he hadn't had this vision of this man in Macedonia, then we wouldn't have this. Then disciples 2,000 years later wouldn't have the same level of confidence about what happened. Now, of course, at the time, Paul had no idea this would happen. But this is how God would use his broken dream, his broken hope. He'd give him a new one. God was using these events for maximum impact, to share the gospel not only with those in Macedonia, but also with us today. He was planning it all out in ways they could never possibly imagine at the time. And this gives us hope that when our dreams seem to fall to the side, we can trust that God's plans and his dreams are always bigger and better than ours, even when we don't understand what's happening. Now, of course, this doesn't mean that when our dreams and hopes fail that it doesn't hurt. Of course it does. But this does tell us an important truth that we need to hold on to at times like that. And that is this, our third point: God is always able to bring about good out of broken hopes and dreams. We set sail from Troas and took a straight course to Samothrace, the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city for some days. So the group decide to be obedient to this vision from God, and they head off over the sea to Macedonia, passing this island called Samothrace on the way. And when they arrive there, they follow a route that leads them to Philippi. But Philippi is a significant place for them to go. I mean, after all, we see that it is a Roman colony. It is a place where a substantial church will later be formed. We find Paul writing to them in our Bibles in the letter to the Philippians. And as the gospel begins to take hold in this Roman colony, so will it begin spreading throughout the whole of the Roman Empire, throughout the whole of Europe, and then all the way throughout the world. All because some hopes and dreams had to be put aside. You see, God is always able to bring about good out of our broken hopes and dreams. That was true in Paul's life, and many of us can testify that it's true for us today. That means when certain hopes go unfulfilled, we never actually lose hope itself. We remain able to hope in what God is able to do. Broken dreams and hopes will not have the last say. And the very best proof of that fact is in the cross, the place that seemed like defeat, the end of hope, the end of a dream, The disciples who were there must have looked on to see their rabbi being crucified and thought that the dream was over. But actually the place where it looked like the dream was over was actually where the dream began. Not a place of defeat, but a place of victory. As the cross will lead to the empty tomb, because this Jesus would rise again. So even when it looks like what God is doing doesn't make sense, we rest in the fact that God's plans are greater than we can imagine, and that he is always able to bring good out of broken hopes and dreams. Amen. Week by week at St. Peter's, we say something called the Creed. It is a statement of belief that Christians have believed for hundreds of years, going back all the way to the early church. So we like to say it together, and we're going to say the Creed together now. So please do join in at home. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And the collect for this feast of Saint Luke. Almighty God, you called Luke the physician, whose praise is in the gospel, to be an evangelist and physician of the soul. By the grace of the Holy Spirit and through the wholesome medicine of the gospel, give your church the same love and power to heal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So now let us pray as our Saviour taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, thank you very much for joining us on this feast of Saint Luke. It's great that you've been able to worship with us today, and do hope you'll be able to join us next time, either here online or on the telephone, or at our parish Eucharist at 10 o'clock, and the first Sunday of the month, our St. Peter's at 4 service, which are service for the whole family. It's a little bit like Messy Church. We had a great time last time, and we're looking forward to the next one in just a couple of weeks. And I'm now going to lead us in our final prayer. So may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.